It's happened. As of today, Tuesday, 19th of January, 2016, I can announce that we've broken the world record for largest prime number ever seen by humans. Yes, humankind has reached further down the number line than ever before and located a prime number. And my goodness, it is amazing. I can officially announce that the new world record biggest prime ever found starts 300376 and then carries on through a lot of other digits, eventually finishing here with 4, 3, 6, 3, 5, 1. And when I mean through a lot of other digits, I am not kidding. This prime measures in at 22,338,618 digits long. It is a massive but entirely prime number marvel. Just how big is a number with 22,338,618 digits? Well, if you tried to print it out and you printed the digits tiny, I'm talking like a millimeter each, because there's a million millimeters per kilometer, this whole number would come out at around about 22 kilometers long. To put that into context, using the standard comparison unit of how many whales would that be? Well, a killer whale is on average 8.7 meters long, and so this number printed out 1 millimeter per digit would be just over 2,567 killer whales in length. That's over 2.5 killer whales. Thankfully, there's a shorthand way to write down this number, which means it has a catchier name than just memorizing all of its digits. You can call it by its nickname, 2 to the power of 74,207,281 minus 1. These numbers, which are 1 less than 2 to the power of something, in this case, if you multiply 2 times 2 times 2, and you multiply 74,207,281 twos together, and then you subtract 1 off that result, you get this prime number. And numbers which are 1 less than a whole lot of twos multiplied together are known as Mersenne numbers, and so this is a Mersenne prime, and to its friends, it's known simply as M74207281. And it should come as no surprise that the new world record biggest prime number found by humans is a Mersenne style prime, because at the moment all of the top 10 biggest primes known to humankind are Mersenne numbers, and that's because they've all come through the same project called the Great Internet Mersenne Prime Search, or you can call it by its acronym GIMPS, which is terrible. Don't search for it. Type out Great Internet Mersenne Prime Search if you want to look it up online. I'm actually joined on the phone by Professor Curtis Cooper, who discovered this new prime number. He's based at the University of Central Missouri, and he's on the line. So, Curtis, can you tell us, how did you actually find out you had discovered this prime number?
It was last Saturday, a week ago, that I got an email about 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, and so just an email saying, by the way, you've discovered the biggest prime number currently known to humankind.
Exactly, exactly. That's exactly how it happened.
Oh, well, so I guess, because you're part of the Great Internet Mersenne Prime Search, does it pretty much just take care of itself and you just get an email notification when you find something?
Yeah, kind of. The way it's supposed to work is supposed to, when a machine on the GIMS project reports a prime to the server, it's supposed to automatically send down an email to the discoverer to notify everybody. But this is our fourth prime, and on all four of those occasions, that email verification has, or notification has failed.
Oh, really?
And yes. And so what actually happened this time was Aaron was just doing some routine data mining or database maintenance, and he saw this result that we had kind of buried in some, I don't know how their database is organized, but he said, boy, this looks odd. They have sometimes they get fake positives, and they have, you know, people that
it's
are
gotta be
reporting
checked and everything, yeah.
Yeah, where they have errors in their, and their machine overheats, and so they report a prime, but it's a fake one or a false one. But he saw this result that came from one of our machines, it was buried in there since September 17th.
So it's been there for months. So he was just checking through the database and went, oh, look, there's a prime here.
That's right, exactly. And so he immediately went and checked the number on his machine, and it came up prime.
That's amazing. So does your record prime count as being discovered when your machine had found it or when they saw it on the server and realized it was there?
It's got to be a human has to take notice of the machine's discovery.
Right.
And so even though it was September 17th when it went into the database, January 7th was when Aaron discovered this in the database, so that's the date of discovery.
Okay, well, I guess the prime always existed, so it's only when a human notices it that it counts.
That's right. There was some embarrassment there that, you know, we went 4 months here without discovering it.
Well, importantly, we've got it now, I guess. That's a big step
forward. That's right. That's right.
Seeing how you've now found four primes, does it get more or less exciting? I mean, what's it feel like to discover your fourth record-breaking prime number?
I think I still have the same excitement as when we were lucky enough to find the first one. I think as it goes, I consider myself really fortunate to be part of this group and these good fellows that run GIMS, and I feel also lucky because I know that I didn't pick that number it was doled out to me, but I think I just feel lucky, and it's exciting the fourth time here as it was exciting the first time.
It's amazing that you're right. They assigned you these numbers, and you happen to find them. Are you running GIMS on above average number of computers? Have you got it running on all of Central Missouri's computer network, or have you just got it on one or two desktops?
No, I have it on. I got permission to run it on several of the labs at University of Central Missouri, and so I would estimate we have maybe 800 computers running it in the different labs.
Oh, fantastic! Now you've discovered this prime. Are there any plans to have it like printed on posters, or are you going to get a T-shirt made? I mean, there's over 22 million digits. Will you ever actually own a copy of it?
Well, there was a company that's now out of business called Perfectly Scientific, and they used to print posters that used a 1-point font and would print all the 9 million digits. That was our first one that we did. They didn't print a poster for the last one that we discovered 3 years ago, and I don't think there's any plans to do it. I'd love to have one because we have the previous ones of our first two, and we have them in our department kind of prominently displayed. But there's not going to be a poster, I don't think, of this one.
It from the interview, but I run an online website called MathsGear, where we make ridiculous mathematical toys and decorations. And I know a printer fairly well. I might have a chat with him and see if it's possible to do something for you.
Okay, you know, in this GIMS community, there's a lot of interest in that kind of stuff. So I know it's not maybe for the general public, but I would be interested in buying more than one of those posters if they would make them.
Oh, I think you get a lifetime supply of posters. But I'll definitely have one. I think a lot of schools and other universities might be interested, so I'll look into it. It's a lot of digits.
Okay.
I'll talk to my printing guys.
That sounds good. We also have a tradition that we've made buttons in our university that kind of have our mascot is a mule, and they'll put the mule on this little button that you can wear on your lapel. And then it has the number there, and then it advertises GIMS. And
when you say the number, you're talking about just 2 to the now power 74 million, et cetera.
That's right. That's
right. Okay,
right.
That's it'd be a massive button otherwise.
And it has our school colors on it, and because I owe a tremendous amount to GIMS and George and Scott and Aaron, and then I also owe a tremendous amount to my university for letting me do this, and it kind of fits into my interests and what I teach and my research interests, and So it's just a win-win for me.
Oh, fantastic. And I know people can get involved by running GIMPs on their computers at home, or they can actually get involved directly with helping out and working on the code and those sorts of things. Do you have any advice, just finally, for anyone, I mean, students at high school right up to researchers, what advice would you give people who want to get involved?
I just say, you know, go to the website, that www.mersim.org, and download the free software that's written by George and sign up as a volunteer. The only strings that are attached is if it's one of the big ones that's worth big prize money, that you have to share it according to their rules, but that's nothing. And it's great for learning about mathematics and computer science and distributed computing and everything. I'd encourage anybody. Anybody could find this.
I know, and I agree completely. I have my computer running, like I said, PrimeGrid, and it's just reassuring to know it's sitting there in the corner. It's ticking over. I mean, it could be contributing to mathematics, and
it's
nice to be part of it. Anyway, Curtis, thank you so much for taking your time to talk to us, and all the best when the news goes public and you're briefly, once again, a mathematical superstar.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Matt. Thank you.
My pleasure. There is one problem here when someone does a heroic feat of finding a 22 million digit prime. There will be other people wandering around asking questions like, what's the point and how is this applicable? Honestly. Well, very sadly, or fantastically, depending on your point of view, there is no actual practical use for Professor Cooper's new prime number. It's just something interesting. It's a huge scientific and mathematical achievement. Although, as much as I hate to admit it, there are some practical applications to the general enterprise of trying to find these ridiculously big prime numbers. It pushes our ability to program and make computers to the absolute proverbial max. Already this year, the great Internet Mersenne Prime Search has been part of finding and diagnosing a problem with modern Intel computer chips. Searching for prime numbers is a fantastic way to stress test modern hardware, and without something like that, we wouldn't be able to develop cutting-edge computers. Well, that's it from me on this breaking prime time news report. Thank you so much to Professor Curtis Cooper for giving the time to talk to me about his incredible discovery, and thank you to the people at the University of Central Missouri for giving him the computer resources, whether they know it or not, to help him find these amazing numbers. And thank you to everyone at the great Internet Mersenne Prime Search, from George Waltman, who started it, right down to the people who work on the code and the databasing, and then right down to the thousands of people who actually run it on their machines. If you'd like to get involved, the links are below in my description of this video. And just go to mersenne.org and skip the whole Googling it step. I mean, the signal to noise ratio is terrible. And finally, I haven't really talked about the actual Mersenne prime number in question. I got so excited about the breaking news and meeting Curtis, but now I have a chance to relax. I can dig through the 22,338,618 digits, and I'm sure there are all sorts of fantastic facts and properties about this number, which I will discover. In the next couple of days, I will actually get another video up, which goes into all the details and properties of this amazing number. So make sure you have subscribed to my channel to see that when it appears. And in the meantime, make sure you join the great Internet Mersenne Prime Search, and maybe next time I will be interviewing you. I mean, statistically, it's very unlikely, I'll be honest.